All right, I think we have a critical mass. So I will begin. Again, I'm Julia Bird, the Vice Chair for the Center for Latin American Studies, and I'm so pleased to welcome you to this event today. The event's title is No Longer a Racial Democracy, Critical Whiteness in Latin America and the Caribbean. And we're really blessed to have three wonderful speakers, Dr. Patricia Pino, Isar Godreo, and Erica Edwards, and it will be moderated by John Mundell. The event will be in English with simultaneous interpretation into Spanish through the Zoom interpretation feature. To access interpretation, click on the globe icon below my image and select Spanish. Este evento será en inglés con interpretación simultánea al español a través de la funcionalidad interpretación de Zoom. Para acceder a la presentación en español, haga clic en el icono del mundo abajo y seleccione español para escuchar el evento en este idioma. This is the fourth and last event in the AfroLatinx Voices series. The series has presented roundtable discussions between Black scholars, activists, and artists from across Latin America and the Caribbean. Each conversation seeks to address how race, Blackness, and anti-Blackness are transnationally informed in conversation across borders, languages, and identities. The AfroLatinx Voices series is presented by the Blackness in Latin America and the Caribbean Working Group and co-sponsored by the Center for Latin American Studies. This event and the rest of the series would not be possible without the generous support from numerous units across campus. Thank you to the departments of African American Studies, Gender and Women's Studies, English, Comparative Literature, Ethnic Studies, and Spanish and Portuguese, as well as Professor Nadia Ellis and the Doreen B. Townsend Center for the Humanities. In a minute, I'll hand you over to the moderator for today's event, John Mundell. But before I do that, let me provide a brief introduction. John is a PhD candidate at UC Berkeley in African American and African Diaspora Studies with a designated emphasis in women, gender, and sexuality. Alongside Nicole Ramsey, he's the co-founder of the Blackness in Latin America and Caribbean Working Group. John's research is on race, sexuality, and popular culture in Latin America and the Caribbean, focusing on Brazil. His dissertation is a queer reading of mainstream Brazilian literature, film, music, and television to show how Brazilian white racially and sexually confines Blackness to the nation's historic fabric. He argues that whiteness in Brazil comes to define itself through a well-rehearsed and recited longing or desire for folkloric Blackness as the site of enactment for national pleasures like racial democracy and mestizaje. And now to finish up with some housekeeping. This event will be recorded. Este evento será grabado. Please feel free to send your questions to the speakers through the Q&A feature, also down below there. And just in case anyone is joining us now, the event will be in Spanish with simultaneous interpretation. I'm sorry, the event will be in English with simultaneous interpretation into Spanish through the Zoom interpretation feature. To access interpretation, click on the globe icon below my image and select Spanish. Este evento será en inglés con interpretación simultánea al español a través de la funcionalidad de interpretación de Zoom. Para acceder a la presentación en español, haga clic en el icono del mundo abajo y seleccione español. And now I'm happy to hand it over to John Mundell.
Thanks, Julia, for that wonderful introduction. I'm so excited to be here. I am going to jump right in. I'm going to introduce each speaker individually, and after which they'll give a brief presentation. And after those three presentations, we'll kind of jump in into a roundtable conversation. And then at the end, we'll have space for Q&A from our illustrious virtual audience. So starting with Patrícia de Santana Pinho, she is a Brazilian social scientist and associate professor in the Department of Latin American and Latino Studies at the University of California, Santa Cruz. She is the author of several publications on Blackness, whiteness, racism, and forms of resistance to racism in Brazil, including two books, Mama Africa, Reinventing Blackness in Bahia, published by Duke University Press in 2010, and more recently in 2018 with University of North Carolina Press, Mapping Diaspora, African American Roots Tourism in Brazil. She has published several articles on whiteness in Brazil like White But Not Quite, Tones and Overtones of Whiteness in Brazil in 2009, and two forthcoming articles this year. First, Whiteness Has Come Out of the Closet and Intensified Brazil's Reactionary Wave, and second, A Casa Grande Surta Quando a Cinzala Aprende a Ler, Resistência Antirracista e o Desvendamento da Branquitude Injuriada. She is co-editing with Hugo Cerrón Anaya and Ana Ramos Sayas a special issue of the journal Latin American and Caribbean Ethnic Studies titled Whiteness in Latin America, Perspectives on Racial Privilege in Everyday Life. Professor Pinho, thank you.
We Thank you. Thank you so much, John. I want to start by thanking John Mondale, Vanessa Castaneda, Jamie Anderson for this really lovely invitation. It's great to be here, especially alongside such great scholars, Isa and Erica. And thanks to the audience, right? We are over 1 year into the pandemic and yet another Zoom event. So I appreciate you taking the time to join us today. I am going to be sharing screen just to try to keep track of time, because the event is really a roundtable, and therefore we are going to speak each one of us just a little bit so that we have time to engage in a conversation. So because of that, I thought I would just do two things. Very briefly go over some definitions of whiteness in Brazilian critical whiteness studies, and then explain what are my contributions to the study of whiteness in contemporary Brazil. And that means looking at a context that is very specific, a context that is marked by what I call the rise of the reactionary wave, the rise of the far right, the election of Bolsonaro as the one of the consequences of that. So I've developed these two concepts, injured whiteness and aspirational whiteness, and I'll briefly explain them and then give us some elements to discuss later on. So to start, I'll just very briefly talk a little bit about some very important definitions of whiteness in Brazil. I should say I'm not going to do justice to the amazing scholarship on whiteness in Brazil and about Brazil. But I would just mention some of the scholars. And of course, we could trace the attention to whiteness way back to Guerrero Ramos, to Lélia Gonzalez. I'm not going to go as far back. I'm really just going to focus a little bit from the early 2000s, when especially social psychologists such as Maria Aparecida Bento and Edith Pisa began publishing on critical whiteness studies. And also, I should say, studies of whiteness in Brazil, as much as studies of whiteness across Latin America, are in a conversation with studies of whiteness in the US, but they should really not be seen as an offshoot of US-based critical whiteness studies. And I'm almost sure my colleagues here will agree with me on that. For Aparecida Bento, whiteness is the social identity of whites, neutral, universal. So we see here definitely an influence of Ruth Frankenberg, for instance. Edith Pisa will also define whiteness as the dominant identity, normative, invisible, preferential. Sueli Carneiro, more recently, I think, talks about the condition of whiteness. So this is not so much a definition, but I think it's important for us to understand the condition of whiteness in a country that has, for a very long time, narrated itself as a racial democracy. And so Sueli Carneiro says, one does not need to subscribe to whiteness to be its beneficiary. And I think this is really important in a country where admitting that someone is white, assuming a white identity, I would say is not, you know, has historically not been dominant, but now, especially with the rise of the far right, it has been the case, which is why one of my recent publications is called Whiteness Has Come Out of the Closet. More recent research on whiteness, such as Valeria Ribeiro Corossacks and Susana Myers, they have really emphasized that because of the dominant narrative of racial democracy, it's important to understand how whiteness operates through other registers that are not always necessarily explicitly racial: morality, respectability, discipline, worthiness, intimacy, etc. And then I also just want to highlight Jennifer Roth Gordon's emphasis on embodied practices and linguistic discipline, also as a focus to study whiteness. And then I want to say, I agree with all of these definitions. I think they are all equally important. What I want to add to the discussion is, and this is, of course, I'm inspired here by Richard Miskolci's understanding, is that in addition to being an identity, a condition, a process, whiteness is also an ideal, and it's ideal that is promoted discursively as a major social value to be preserved, thus my concept of injured whiteness, and then to be acquired by those who do not partake in it. Thus my concept of aspirational whiteness. So this is where then I want to jump into these concepts. But before I do so, I just want to, one more thing to say is that we cannot discuss whiteness in Brazil without taking into account the legacy of slavery, right? We had over 350 years of history of slavery, and we live with this deep legacy that has a sum of its consequences, the association between Blackness and manual labor, a deep racial hierarchy, the idea that Blacks and poor people should quote unquote know their place. And this is all playing out very concretely in the context of the rise of the far right in Brazil. And then another point to keep in mind is that during slavery in Brazil, one did not need to be wealthy to be a slave owner. So it was not that difficult to be a slave owner in that context. And that was somewhat something that a lot of people aspired to. So I really think there's a link between the aspirational whiteness of today and that process in the context of slavery. So I won't describe in depth the 13 years in which the Workers' Party was in power in Brazil. As you know, the PT, the Partido dos Trabalhadores, went through four consecutive presidencies, and then the fourth one was abruptly interrupted through the institutional coup that removed Dilma Rousseff from the presidency. And I don't mean to romanticize any of this, but it is undeniable that deep social transformations took place. And these are just here on the slide, just some of the examples of these transformations. So as a result of these social transformations and the social ascension of the poor, the majority of whom are Black, the widespread implementation of affirmative action, programs such as Bolsa Família, Mais Médicos, etc. As a result of that, there was a strident reaction of the traditional middle class in Brazil. And to a great extent, this strident reaction has been classified as a class resentment, which it is a class resentment, no doubt, but I think what has been missing from the analysis is an attention to whiteness. What role has whiteness played in the rise of the far right? And I then developed the concept of injured whiteness because I think it's important to look at the racial dimension of this class resentment. And then I won't get into details here, but we can talk about it later on. Injured whiteness really is a result of the crisis of this dominant model, a significant change in the status quo, and it really reveals this moment in which whiteness has been interpolated, summoned, called into place, removed from its comfortable position of neutrality. And then these two processes of whiteness outing itself, but then being outed by anti-racist scholars and activists. However, because it operates discursively, whiteness as an ideal is not restricted to those who directly benefit from it. Whiteness appeals also to those who are hurt by it. And then I want to just mention here some statistics, because 2 years later, I still cannot get over this. During the elections of Bolsonaro, 45% of Black Brazilians voted for Bolsonaro. I'm going to say that again, 45% of Black Brazilians. That's mind-blowing. And then 64% of Brazilians who make between two and five minimum wages also voted for Bolsonaro. So that is why initially I thought, this is a moment for me to really study up and focus on whiteness. It's about the middle class, the upper classes, but actually whiteness circulates discursively, and therefore there's an impact on how an appeal among the lower classes also. So that's why then I developed this concept of aspirational whiteness. And both of these concepts make sense together. They go hand in hand. And also, they are a work in progress. And I'm just going to end on this slide here, really just explaining that aspirational whiteness, even though I'm using that more to think of the lower classes, and then injured whiteness more to think of the middle and upper classes, they could also operate in opposite ways. But as far as how it aspirational whiteness operates among the lower classes, I would say it's very much about a deliberate disidentification from the so-called internal enemy, whether it is the marginal, bandido, or the beneficiaries of social programs or members of social movements. But it really requires a production of a lower other for those who are themselves already lowered and othered. So this is not to say all Black people or all poor people aspire to whiteness, absolutely not. And in fact, my article on the Casa Grande Surta goes in the, shows the opposite process to that. But I think it is really important that we try to understand the role that whiteness has played, especially as an ideal in the context of the rise of the far right in Brazil. So I'm gonna end here so that we have enough time to discuss and then listen to our colleagues.
Thank you so much, Dr. Pinho. So let's just dive right in. Our next presenter is Dr. Isar Gudro. She is a researcher at the Institute for Interdisciplinary Research at the University of Puerto Rico at Calle, where she directs various institution-wide level research initiatives and her own research projects. Her publications explore issues of race, racism, and identity in Puerto Rico and the Caribbean. She has published on hair, racial terminology, the folklorization of Blackness, census racial categories, the effects of racism in Puerto Rican schools, and more recently on the status of higher education in the aftermath of Hurricane Maria. She is the author of Arrancando Mitos de Raíz, Guía para la Enseñanza Antirracista de la Herencia Africana en Puerto Rico, published in 2013, and published in 2015, Scripts of Blackness, Race, Cultural Nationalism, and U.S. Colonialism in Puerto Rico, which is also the winner of the Frank Bonilla Best Book Award. Dr. Gudro studied at the University of Puerto Rico, Rio Piedras, and later obtained her PhD in cultural anthropology from the University of California, Santa Cruz. Dr. Gudro?
Thank you. Thank you for the invitation. I'm going to share my screen. I really appreciate you guys organizing this event and everyone who's watching. It's an honor to be here with my colleagues. Okay, so let's see if this works. Sometimes it gives me a little bit. Okay, hopefully everybody can see. So I thought I would just start with this quote, and I'm thinking here of the whiteness that Patricia is talking about, more the aspirational whiteness. These lower middle class or working class people in Puerto Rico. This quote was a part of a focus group we were doing across the island in 2000 in the context of the U.S. Census results just coming out. Before going into the quote itself, let me just give you some context of the census. At that time, the Puerto Rico seemed to be the whitest country in the Americas, right? With 81% of Puerto Ricans choosing white only in the census. Of course, as you can see, we have the same census that is used in the US, but just translated into Spanish, which poses another set of problems and difficulties. But with this form, the 81% at that time of the population marked only white. And so when we asked, people doing focus groups across the island, we would get, this is one quote from a man who said, well, en casa todos somos blanco, nosotros no somos negros puro, negro violeta, sino bien mezclados, right? And so I think it goes to some of the popular notions of whiteness that are important to understand the results, not elite definitions of whiteness, which are much more just exclusive, but this can be, it speaks to what other scholars have said, in Latin America about whiteness being a kind of elastic term in the Caribbean. Lilian Guerra and other scholars have talked about, how in the Hispanic Caribbean, you can even have degrees of whiteness when you are negotiating these identities. And that it is a kind of whiteness that is not necessarily in contradiction with mixture, or that is canceled by mixture, which is, somewhat different from the notions of dominant one-drop rule notions that of mixture that we find in the US. In fact, whiteness is sometimes, as in the quote said by this man, facilitated by a mixture. And so such popular notions of whiteness are not necessarily, or aspirational notions of whiteness are not necessarily associated with purity or a restricted sense of essence. In fact, it is the what is essentialized is really blackness, right? Blackness in opposition to this more elastic notion of whiteness. Blackness then is more restrictive, more narrowly defined, and it's a sort of a pure essence almost that can be aspirationally canceled by mixture, right? So it is interesting to see, you know, to understand how whiteness operates in terms of how mixture is defined differently at different moments in times. Because, you know, the results in Puerto Rico could have gone a number of ways, right? People could have distanced themselves from blackness, which is, you know, also driving the results, right? If you see 81% of the population identifying this way, it's definitely because the stigma associated, you know, to blackness coming from enslavement, right? And all that implied is still prevalent here. So I really like, Patricia, your arrow, you know, I'm pointing to how important is the history of enslavement, especially in Puerto Rico and Brazil, which were sites in which, you know, the abolition came very, very late, you know, so it hasn't even been 145 years since abolition came to our land. So this is a very close history. So that stigma is still operating there, but it could have been, you know, people could have chosen choose other categories, but they chose white only, right? So it speaks to, you know, how these notions are conceived in a context where mixture is understood as a sign and evidence of non-blackness. And also then there's the role of the state and the local government in Puerto Rico, even though it's a colonial state for many years, including in 2000, when it had more funding, would promote, you know, this idea of Puerto Rico being white and mixed race identities as operating separately from notions of whiteness in the North. So it was like, you know, ellos allá, nosotros acá. You know, that's their racial thing. That's their, you know, that they have their exclusive whiteness over there. We here are, you know, can talk about a criollo kind of whiteness, a different, more flexible kind of whiteness, and that should not interfere. But you know, in my current work now, what I'm doing with Yarimar Bonilla, my colleague, we're looking at how the current socioeconomic and political crisis in Puerto Rico is transforming these ideas. So since 2006 and especially after the 2000 census, when you had, you know, 81% of the population declaring themselves as white only, after that, you know, Puerto Rico began experiencing serious a set of economic, socioeconomic and political crises, which made the government, you know, and the situation are much more very colonial in much more explicit, unequivocal, and open manner. The effects of colonial austerity imposed by the combination of neoliberal economic policies and colonial forms of U.S. government made themselves quite much more evident after 2000. So I don't know, for those of you who don't know a little bit of the context of Puerto Rico has been a colony of the US since 1898. We are US citizens at birth, but island residents cannot vote in US elections and have no right representatives in Congress. We have been defined as belonging to, but not being part of the United States. But this, you know, this colonial status had sort of been a little bit veiled through government funding for a while. But starting in 2016, you know, Obama actually signed a law called Promesa, and we had a seven-member fiscal board appointed. These seven members, which are unelected, that now make decisions over the fiscal future of Puerto Rico, since we have to, you know, pay $120 billion public debt. And so based on that, we are our forms of governments and public, because of public austerity, extreme public austerity, then the notion of coloniality has been made more evident, and that became worse than after Maria and the hurricanes and the earthquakes, and now with COVID. So our colonial situation is sort of much more in our face, basically, just to say. And then so we, me and Yarimar, we did this survey across the island with more than 1,000 participants right about the time when the junta, the seven unelected board, was appointed. And we asked people, ¿cuál es tu identificación racial? In an open question. We had no boxes, just open. And it was a lot of work dividing up the results, you know, and because it was, you know, there were qualitative data basically that we have to turn into categories. But what happens, and this is what usually happens, you know, when you have an open question, the number of people who identified as white was reduced. But we've also seen that reduction after the crisis, even in census, in the, you know, American Community Census, et cetera, which are estimates, to go down. So we're no longer at 81%. We're actually even at 65%, even looking at estimates in the census. And we had here much lower, 20% of the interviewees. And so I'll just highlight some three interesting results that we found from that exercise. It was like, for example, about half of those who said they were white, they would talk about that whiteness as a sort of qualified form of whiteness that was not really, it should not be understood as Anglo whiteness or as US whiteness. So we see now in this moment where coloniality is much more in our faces, a more close presence of a, you know, a metropolitan other who has a sort of whiteness that is not the whiteness that I'm claiming here to be. And so we would hear answers like, I am a white Hispanic or white Latina or white Puerto Rican or blanca quemada or white but a mix, you know. So I'm not saying I am white like a gringa white, right? So this is what we said. We saw these kinds of responses with almost half of the people that said whiteness. Another trend that we thought was interesting is that, you know, in many of the answers, even though this was an open question, you know, it was made by Puerto Ricans in Puerto Rico, by Puerto Rican students, but people still would talk about a sort of observant, vigilant other when they would say, you know, I'm Latina, supongo, I'm trigueña, pero se pone blanca. Like you put white on those things, you know, like because there's someone that would have another, you know, another way of viewing this. Boricua, pero ahora si se arregla seré americano, caucásico me ponen, like other people put me on like this. So there's, you know, definitely another interlocutor. And the other thing that we find is a correlation with age, right? So more of the older people were the ones who were naming themselves or calling themselves white, while younger people, the tendency was to adopt other categories like Latino. Latino is interesting, and we can talk about that also, but we feel it's like more of the encroachment of US formulations of race that are happening in Puerto Rico, which before we didn't, in 2000, we were not seeing that kind of use of Latino in the archipelago in Puerto Rico. So anyways, those were three interesting trends that I want to talk to you more later about. But basically our conclusion is that local notions of whiteness, you know, this elasticity that we had seen in the year 2000 is shrinking, as notions of whiteness are compromised as a legitimate category for people who are in a much more overtly colonial and vulnerable situation. Due to the, you know, fiscal crisis and the extreme neoliberal austerity measures that are being implemented. And this became worse after Maria and with the earthquakes and now with COVID, of course. So the political crisis of the last decade combined with the ongoing aftershocks has transformed, definitely, we think, local understandings of whiteness aspirational whiteness, right? And how Puerto Rico fits and people's notions of how Puerto Rico fits within the larger racial imperial formation of the United States. So I will leave it there and thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Goodreau. I really appreciate that. Finally, Professor Erica Denise Edwards is an associate professor of Latin American history at the University of North Carolina at Charlotte. She has recently published the book Hiding in Plain Sight, Black Women, the Law, and the Making of a White Argentine Republic, which is a gendered analysis of Black erasure and the construction of race in Argentina. It has won the 2020 Association of Black Women Historians Letitia Woods Brown Book Prize and named one of 2020 best books of Black history by the African American Intellectual History Society. Edwards has been interviewed and consulted by New York Review of Books, The New York Times, National Geographic, and La Voz del Interior, an Argentine newspaper. Edwards' research advocates for relearning of Argentina's Black past and the origins of anti-Blackness. Her advocacy extends to community engagement, where she currently serves as a member of the Board of Directors for Latin Americans Working for Achievement, or LAWA, an organization that grants scholarships to Latinx students to pursue post-secondary education. And without further ado, Dr. Edwards.
Hi, everyone, and thank you so much for that introduction, as well as the invitation, John, as well as Nicole, to give this talk and engage in this roundtable. And especially, I'm so excited about Black and what it's been doing. So congratulations to you and UC Berkeley. So this is going to be essentially a very brief overview of the construction of whiteness in Argentina, and just, again, allow us to hopefully springboard into more interesting questions during the roundtable. So what I found while investigating the disappearance of Blackness is ultimately I had to engage within what exactly is Argentina and how does Argentina try to construct itself? And in the end, it is imagined to be a white nation. And so this is really, I'm so excited to be able to have this conversation about joining critical whiteness, because still I find the Southern Cone is left out of this conversation. And yet in many ways, whiteness has become the so-called standardization of identity that it's almost thought of as an afterthought to even include scholarship about whiteness in Argentina. So essentially what I've found is the themes of whiteness, or the constructions, the contours of whiteness, comes down to the ideas of citizenship, foreign intervention, myths of disappearance, and then finally the racialization of class, which ultimately would create then a white nation, but more importantly, a homogeneous nation. Homogeneity ultimately is the goal, and we find this towards the end of the 19th century. However, as the talk will eventually conclude, those cracks are starting to appear in this melting pot of immigration today. So briefly speaking, then, looking at and understanding citizenship, this comes from actually the beginnings of the republics, I want to stress the plural, of Argentina. And so ultimately we're looking at the post-colonial experience, in which we have a Buenos Aires, which is different than a Cordoba, which is different than Cusco area, which is different than a Tucumán. And what we're finding very, as these intellectuals such as Sarmiento come forward, is there's a clear dichotomy that is at times an antithesis to each other. One in which whiteness starts to emerge as being urban versus those that are rural. One in which a litoral, or the Buenos Aires, then becomes the epitome of what will essentially be whiteness versus the interior as it starts to come forward. And ultimately, one in which someone is educated versus those that are considered to be ignorant. Ignorant also referring to this notion of moral ignorance. What I found just in my own research and looking at the construction of race in Cordoba was I saw a shift, especially in terms of the census data and the labeling, the relabeling, in which I actually found by 1821 and definitely by 1832 that they are consciously referring to themselves as blancos. So you clearly see, even in the state notion of what they are, is whiteness then is starting to engage and capture these elements. From there, to kind of wrap that up, what we're seeing then is, as I mentioned, Sarmiento, and this notion of civilization versus barbarism, which will then, of course, come into play towards the latter half of the 19th century with, as I described before, this notion of foreign intervention. And this foreign intervention will first, of course, come strongly influence Buenos Aires, and then ultimately the Pampas or parts of the interior, and then lastly, the Northwestern provinces. And it's ultimately state-sanctioned immigration and this notion of looking for an ideal replacement, one that could be used as a emblem as well as a model to follow for those that ultimately are in Argentina but just don't have what it takes to make a modern nation. So we see already with the Constitution of 1853, there's now starting to form a space for European immigration specifically, but definitely by 1876 with the Immigration and Colonization Law, in which they also describes exactly what they are looking for, which is ultimately Northern Europeans. This, of course, is not unique to Argentina. And we find that blancamiento, as it's oftentimes noted, it takes place throughout all of Latin America, and to some extent, I even argue the United States. What makes it, however, astounding is the amount that goes to Argentina. It is second to the United States in terms of immigration. By 1895, you're looking at 2 out of 3 people in Buenos Aires that are foreign. By 1914, half of the city, this is Buenos Aires, is foreign. But I must stress this immigration is not equally spread throughout what is now the country. And so instead in the interior, you're finding that there are less immigrants that are headed to the such as Tucumán or Jujuy or even Córdoba. They will come, but they will come a little bit later. Another thing that a lot of people forget about, but I'm hoping more scholarship will come forth, is the education aspect and the recruitment of American white women teachers, to be exact, that came also to Argentina in order to implement the normal school, starting, of course, in BA, but the ultimate goal was to go to the interior. Again, this notion of this rustic, rural interior that needed to be educated. So we're also seeing that aspect. So it's not just Europeans, specifically men or Northern Europeans. It's also, we see how the US is playing a role in this process. Another thing I want to stress, though, is the census data. Interestingly enough, we're starting to see less of an emphasis on those that are Argentine in terms of those that are of Afro descent or of Indigenous descent. But interestingly enough, we do have the census data of the immigrants that came to Argentina, and they are racialized. And what it's showing is that overwhelmingly, of course, majority are from Europe, but we do find that there are some Asians and there are some Africans that are also coming over. what I wanted to really stress is by 1895, they note them. By 1914, they're now considered unspecified in terms of immigrants. So this is also shifting us to then these myths of disappearance. And that's another wave that comes forth roughly around the same time, but definitely by the 1940s, this notion that ultimately any remnants of what was of Afro descent, of Indigenous descent and or Indians is gone, okay? And that is really where we see this in the census data. I just wanted to read a very small quote in which one of the directors of the Second National Census of Argentina states or explains why race was not included. And ultimately he says, The question of race is of little importance to Argentina, given, and I quote, the small numbers in both absolute and relative terms of blacks, mulattoes, and civilized Indians. Another thing that he stresses then is Also, given there is one exception, however, for pure Blacks who cannot pass. All the rest, mulattoes and Indians, oftentimes are recounted as whites. So we're already seeing this kind of shift to this, creating this homogeneity of what is ultimately Argentina, and Argentina, especially by the end of the 19th century, is, or at least they want to project themselves as being a white nation. Within the interior as well, we see the 1879 conquest of the desert, as well as the 1884 movement toward or colonization process and movement of modernization process, excuse me, in the Chaco, again, to move forward this notion that they are modernizing the state and bringing forth these new ideas of what is civilization. And then lastly, one of the things in terms of looking at the myths of disappearance, a third attribute of whiteness is these relabelings of these formerly non-white or those that do not fit into this notion of what is whiteness. So you have, for example, a criollo that comes forth. I did definitely want to highlight Chamosa's work in that regard. And what you find, criollo then starts to envelop this notion of, you know, what is considered to be American born, and ultimately first used to describe American born whites and as a comparison to those that were peninsulares. But then eventually it starts to capture this notion of being native, right? And native in terms of that you were born in the Americas. And so we start to see this relabeling of Indians to criollos. We also start to see at the beginnings of the 19th century, this notion of morocho that also comes forward and is still widely used today. Another way to capture kind of these darker skinned peoples that are not quite fitting into what is whiteness just yet, but are definitely not Black. excuse me. In Cordoba, again, my own research showed this catch-all phrase of pardo being used, especially during the Republic, to replace all formerly labeled castas. And then of course, trigueños, which has been studied in Buenos Aires to catch these notions of those that are dark skinned immigrants, often from Europe, as well as light skinned Blacks. And so we're starting to see how this otherness is starting to develop as well. And I must stress that not only is this from the top down or from the state down, but it's also from the bottom up, right? This is the ways in which those that don't quite fit into whiteness can at least start to maneuver socially, the social mobility, at least to escape levels of their Blackness or levels of being an Indian, simply because at this point in time, any level of cultural references to their ethnicities or their race is a negative connotation. And so what we see again is this downplaying of all these cultural practices and this shift also, and I really want to stress, especially for the Tucumán area, this shift in from this indigenous notions and cultural practices, language now being ultimately eliminated in some sense, this shift to subsistence ranching, to agrarian capitalism. Again, Chamosa really talked about this in terms of sugar. Blackness, of course, you know, anything that's associated with that, whether that be the music, tango, milongo, carnival, anything, then of course, if they can downplay that cultural aspect, and of course, at times even adopt this notion of trigueño, that is a way to at least move towards this notion of whiteness. And so by the beginning of the 20th century, looking at then whiteness in terms of how class is racialized, what I want to stress is clearly they don't disappear, right? We're seeing these in terms of these state measures such as the census, but phenotypically, right? It's not as if somebody is just going to one day just become white. So what is happening then? What I'm finding more and more is that race then just becomes a silent topic, right? You just don't talk about it. You just don't act Black or act Indian, right? You hold on to these notions of being a criollo, you hold on to these notions and ultimately becoming a morocho. In some ways, it's a romanticized notion of a gaucho, if we can even go that far. But it's actually at the moment during the Peronist years that we see again this head-to-head coming forward. And his call for all those from the interior that in many ways still hold on or have these levels of phenotype, dark phenotype, now coming to Buenos Aires, where you see this clash again of interior versus the coast. And it is at that point, then we start to see how race how class becomes racialized. And we start to see these, you know, derogatory terms coming forth, such as cabecita negra, to ultimately describe, you know, these dark skinned people that never went anywhere, but it still are in many ways a problematic reminder for those that have adopted and can ascribe to whiteness, is now looking and saying, no, what is this, right? And to what extent does that make or explain who we are as an Argentine nation? And so so we see this cabecita negra then come forth, but it's also one in which it's very ambiguous as well, but it clearly marks a difference between those that are white and those that are not. And so we also start to see the racialization of the word even negro coming forth, as well as cabecita negra, to some extent is still maybe used, but not as much as just the overall a word negro, which is used to describe, again, those that are not white. And in turn, we start to see then how class, especially middle class, then becomes part of that conversation to allow for people who want to still claim whiteness to hold on to that whiteness. So not only then are you looking at the ideal European immigrant and their descendants, but as I'm finding these, there's also these local notions of how a trigueño or moreno or morocho can have these appearances, right, of whiteness and still hold on to, not hold on to, but claim and subscribe to whiteness because they are now part of that middle class. And then those that do not hold on to levels of these cultural traits of whiteness will then be unfortunately demonized in many ways and called at times the, in a derogatory way, negro. So just kind of to wrap up, because I know I'm really looking forward to the conversation. What we're seeing is that at least within Argentina over these last, you know, 200 years, that there is a very much whiteness is tied to citizenship. It's tied to foreign intervention. It's tied to the myths of disappearance. And of course, the racialization of class. And it's ultimately either you're in or you're not, or you're out. And in creating this homogeneous, raceless nation, we still see how in many ways it's considered to be the standardization of identity. But since 2001, a new shift of immigration, a darker immigration is coming forth. And so we're starting to see these cracks develop. And that's exciting to see then how whiteness will ultimately become flexible and find another way to continue to at least maintain its privilege. Thank you.
Thank you everyone for those wonderful presentations. We have about, I'd say 20, 25 minutes to have a conversation and then go into some round table, some Q&A to try and kind of close out by about 11:25, 11:30 California time. So I wanted to, many questions to ask, but I'll just pick and choose some. I was wondering, you know, throughout Latin America and the Caribbean, and, you know, Dr. Gaudreau, this shows up especially with your presentation on the census data, the way we talk about race and its categories is pervasive in everyday speech, right? This is especially the case for describing the varying degrees of Blackness, such that for better or for worse, Blackness becomes pluralized and multiplicitous and can easily feed into the idea of racial democracy. But in Brazil, more recently even, we often hear this with the term negritugis, you know, in the plural, or blacknesses, to give space for the multiple ways of being and living one's blackness, right? So, however, in whiteness, it's still often seen as singular or discussed in very theoretical ways. So I wonder how we might rethink whiteness in the plural, and we do hear this more recently in Brazil with branquitudes, like whitenesses, right? But how we might rethink whiteness in the plural as well is very different from place to place. And you all can just jump in and feel free.
Can I say some, just briefly? Mm-hmm. I think actually it's part of, at least from Puerto Rico, you know, and for the people who are engaged in anti-racist work, this issue of understanding Blackness as plural and as more flexible is part of the political project, right? It's part of an anti-racist agenda, because the norm has been actually to make Blackness very narrow. And what is flexible is whiteness, right? It's because people keep stretching it so that, you know, it works as a strategy of blanqueamiento. If you can't change your, you know, phenotypic features, like Erica said, it's not like all of a sudden people woke up and they were lighter or whiter. It's just what you do is you change the definition, right? And so I think it's part of making Blackness more plural that is part of the anti-racist work that I see happening now. So just to point that out.
Mm. Yeah, I agree with that. And I think it would apply to Brazil as well. And what came to my mind, John, as I was listening to your question, and also very much as I was listening to Isna's presentation, was that, you know, kind of classic example of the very racial categories in Brazil, you know, when the census opened up the question of race, and then we had 134 racial color terms. And when you look at the category branco, you know, branco encardido, branco leite, branco, you know, there are so many different ways of qualifying branco, mm-hmm. that I think proves the point that Isa is making about widening whiteness to make as many people as possible fit. So I think it really depends a lot on who is doing this kind of pluralization of whiteness, what form, in what moment. And the same would apply to negritudes and blackness, right? Not that that answers the question, but I think those are just elements to kind of think about in different moments in time.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Professor Edwards, did you don't feel pressured? We can just move on, or I didn't know if you wanted to add anything from the case of Argentina. Or
no, you can move on. It's fine.
Okay, sure. So I guess, you know, Dr. Gaudreau, your book, and this is for everyone, but just to kind of put into perspective, Dr. Gaudreau, your book, Scripts of Blackness, goes into intimate detail on how, you know, whiteness has historically been constructed as benevolent in Puerto Rico, especially in comparison to the US. You know, your presentation mm-hmm. talks about that too, within the context of slavery and imagining the mestizo nation, and Blackness is relegated to ahistorical folklore, right? Especially in areas like music, dance, food, sport, often in hypersexual and hypergendered ways, right? So these racial scripts, as you call them, are recited and reworked in multiple arenas of life, you know, from politics and schools to popular culture and everyday speech. And I, you know, kind of going with that concept of scripts as performance, right? I would like to know, to talk about how these racial scripts show up in the current work of all of you, but also from a discursive standpoint, how we might better understand them as a performance, kind of given on various types of stages and requiring their own set of costumes, props, rehearsals, you know, recitations, et cetera.
Yeah, it's a good question. I think, well, actually, what I'm seeing now is interesting, because I think these scripts, you know, these racial scripts, and how what the the meanings that are attached to Blackness or indigeneity or whiteness, especially Hispanic whiteness, right, which has a different, is constructed differently vis-a-vis Anglo whiteness, right? But I think they all need the state, a state to promote them, right? And the state needs funding, money. And right now in this neoliberal moment of colonial neoliberalism that we are living, the state has no funds to fund the scripts, has very little funds. So it's an interesting moment because I'm seeing is that the what used to be the previous, you know, notion of racial democracy, of an autonomous, claiming an autonomous Hispanic whiteness that had somehow nothing to do with the gringo whiteness that was supposed to be over there, you know, that needs funding to be able to be put into practice and for people to believe it, right? And at this moment, the government is in bankrupt, right? The colonial government is in bankruptcy. So the props to promote the scripts are not, there's not a lot of money to buy props, right? The education system, the communication systems is we are in a moment where there is much more a US federal encroachment of you know, racialized definitions of whiteness and Blackness. Or even mixture. So it is an interesting moment, and I don't think it's a bad thing that the local government doesn't have funding for scripts of racial democracy. I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing. It's just that now we are seeing other ways of performing Blackness that I think actually do what you say, that it's expand the notion of Blackness to include, you know, other signs that were previously associated with the English Caribbean or with even US notions of Blackness, which are much more conceived as more modern or hip or urban, you know, than the folkloric notions that are supported by the state, by the Puerto Rican colonial state. So I think it's an interesting moment that we're seeing right now, especially with the murdering of George Floyd, you know, and all the activism around that, and in combination with local scripts of Blackness in Puerto Rico not having enough funds, then that generates an interesting combination, a much livelier space for anti-racist activism in Puerto Rico, I think. Mm-hmm. Anyway, that's...
Mm-hmm.
I'll leave it there.
I'll speak a little bit in terms of Argentina, and what really struck me is how these scripts of culture are constantly adopted, right, and used to ultimately propel a national identity. Well, in Argentina, you know, thinking about the tango, for example, or the cuarteto, which is in the interior, or even the drink mate, right? All of these were things that were considered to be anti-European for years, but now have become ultimately what makes Argentina, Argentina. So again, just talking about how whiteness continues to expand and is quite flexible in terms of making sure, again, that a certain group and status quo maintains levels their power dynamics by including certain things, certain cultural aspects, right, of these people, but not the people themselves. Mm-hmm. In order for the people themselves to be a part of that, they in a sense have to let go of their culture, and then eventually, once it's become nationalized and adopted as if this is again a Argentine whiteness attribute versus something that came from them, there's such a disconnect. For example, in understanding the origins of mate, or, you know, tango now is becoming more and more acknowledged as its Black roots. But mate, in a sense, I mean, this is something that nobody drank years and years ago. This is something that the poor drank. And now this is, you know, what everybody drinks in their house, even more so at times than coffee. So I wanted to throw that out. And then lastly, with Maradona, right, and what he represents, I mean, and thinking again of a personal experience where someone had told me, you know, he represented Los Negros, you know, he was our Malcolm X. And the fact that he was able to transcend and become again this Argentine emblem of whiteness, in a sense, definitely the Argentine identity on the international stage. But yet when we really think of his origins and what he represents, they're still, you know, discriminated at such levels, you know, because they cannot obviously or do not have the talents that Maradona had to allow him to escape at times these notions of blackness, in quotation.
Yeah, I think that's such an important question about performance and performances of blackness and whiteness and thinking about them together. What I would also perhaps add to it is the question about where can whiteness be performed and where can blackness be performed? And I won't really answer the question, but I would just, beginning to think about it, I would say, you know, up until the Workers' Party's presidency, which is really a watershed moment in Brazilian history, especially as it pertains to the social ascension of the poor and therefore the changes in the racial dynamics, right? Class and racial dynamics. Whiteness could basically just be performed anywhere because of its supposed neutrality, but blackness couldn't really, right? Blackness had very contained spaces where it was very visible, celebrated, but as Isa and Erica are saying, very kind of guided by the state, right? And then the tourism industry alongside with that. And then when blackness becomes performed everywhere, in the shopping malls and the airports and the airplanes, and then no, then that's wrong, right? That's blackness in the wrong place. So I think, you know, I would just add to the question of performance, the question of where that performance takes place.
Mm-hmm. Excellent, thank you so much. I just think also, you know, how place does play a very important role and how certain places get, you know, racialized in different ways, be it, you know, Loíza in Puerto Rico or be it Bahia in Brazil, that's, you know, as the expected, right, of space that these racial performances are happening or not happening, right, is just a crucial question to keep asking ourselves about, you know, how we can re-envision racial performance as plural, right, as the multiple ways of performing blackness or performing whiteness or mixed raceness or even just how kind of this multiplicity of location is very crucial in how we envision race making and nation making at the same time, right? So I want to talk a little bit about methodology because I know all of your works really, you know, you cite and you envision and you enact kind of a Black feminist praxis in your work, be it in history or social sciences or humanities. And, you know, critical whiteness is long kind of been a tenet of interdisciplinary Black studies in the US, mostly to describe, of course, like the intersections of race and class, especially, you know, to engage the privilege and politics of even poor and working class white people, right? But it's in these more recent times, it feels like the work that is coming out of Latin American and Caribbean studies about whiteness is really coming from, you know, a Black feminist lens. It cites transnational Black feminist thought, you know, as the school that's really kind of putting whiteness up for questioning, right? And I see this is definitely a necessary turn, especially since it is this work that considers not only like the racial and but gendered and sexual politics of whitening via miscegenation as a state-sponsored program, you know, whose repercussions we still feel in the 21st century. So I guess as scholars of race, gender, place, and memory, you know, of work that I would consider to be rooted in a Black feminist praxis, you know, how do you kind of envision the role of Black feminisms and deconstructing whiteness in Latin America and the Caribbean?
Yeah, I mean, I could mention that I think there's been a really productive convergence in Brazil. Again, very much as I wouldn't say, well, in part the result of this period of, you know, the widening of affirmative action, the entrance of a much larger number of Black students, Indigenous students, et cetera, in universities. I think so the convergence between that and then social media, and then how a lot of the times young activists, especially young Black activists, many times trans, feminist, female, have used especially YouTube, but also Instagram, Facebook, etc. But I think YouTube has been a major platform in Brazil. So the convergence between these two elements, I think, has contributed a lot to disseminate ideas that usually are just discussed in the ivory tower, right, in the universities. And so it's been great to see these, even the very, if we think of Brazil, the very term branquitude, the normalization of the term is a result to a great extent of this channeling through social media mostly of the voices and the perspectives of Black feminist thought predominantly because of this convergence again of, you know, affirmative action and social media happening simultaneously to a great extent. So I guess I would begin with that. And then also just throw in there the fact that this has also contributed to a resurgence of people like Lélia Gonzalez, for instance. When I was in college, when I graduated in social sciences, we didn't talk about Lélia Gonzalez. She was not anywhere to be seen in the in our curriculum. Or others, right? Beatriz Nascimento and other feminists, Black feminist intellectuals that today have been rediscovered. And today they are, their work is just circulating so much more. So I just wanted to mention that as one of the very positive outcomes of this really, really difficult moment we're living, like overall across the board, across the Americas, but particularly in Brazil with, you know, a neo-fascist in power, and so that we don't just lose hope completely, you know, so it's important to see that that work is happening at the same time that Bolsonaro is in power, right?
Okay. Argentina, in regards to Black feminist scholarship, we are still at the very beginning in many ways. There hasn't really been a lot. Part of some of my writing is starting to emerge. We do have a few scholars that are, you know, up in the pipeline, but in terms, but we are, the three that I am familiar with, we are not Argentines. Those that are Black feminists and that are really pushing this question of what is whiteness and belonging really are the activists on the ground that are doing amazing work. And most recently, they finally allowed for and created an anti-racism course in the School of Law for the University of Buenos Aires, which is being led by these Black feminist scholars and other activists to actually teach what's happening on the ground. At this point right now, the issue is just acknowledging that they're there. We still are at that point in many ways of, you know, of course, explaining what happened, but really for those that are now descendants of slaves, that are descendants of the Cape Verdean migration, and then the most recent explosion from West Africa, is to acknowledge that they are there and they are also Argentine. So that's really where we're at. We're still at the beginnings of this, you know, Black feminist practices and activism. We're getting there.
just briefly in Puerto Rico, and I think this happens also in the Hispanic Caribbean, it's really Black women who are at the forefront of all the anti-racist movements. I mean, in Puerto Rico, we have La Colectiva Feminista. They've been doing amazing work of you know, always linking gender violence to racism, to colonialism, and never forgetting to link. Colectivo Ile is another colectivo mainly, geared by women, looking at the intersection of colonialism, gender, racism. Even though I don't see it in the scholarship that much, like Erika says, I do see it in the actual activism that is taking place, and people on the ground are making those linkages in very explicit ways.
Yeah, you know, coming from a more of a cultural studies background, looking at like literature and film and television, you know, the way that certain figures of history get, or even present day kind of get tokenized, right? In the way how whiteness is really always kind of pulling the puppet strings of who is directing and writing these movies. And, you know, I research like telenovelas, I'm writing about the telenovela Chica da Silva right now. So, you know, these certain figures, how they show up. And, you know, Patricia, Dr. Pinho, you talk about social media, and it feels like social media, as well as like, you know, kind of activism in the streets and, you know, in kind of the URL world, is really kind of the more almost democratic space of cultural production, right? Where maybe like, we can imagine kind of liberation in other types of ways, about how many of these terms, be it branquitudes or blanquitudes or whiteness, is kind of becoming more vernacular, right? Through this activism and through kind of the production of images and, you know, be it memes, you know, thinking about like fascist Barbie memes in the case of Brazil, which is something I'm really excited to write about. And, you know, all these other kind of ways that we can approach it, also through humor and satire, et cetera, is really exciting, you know, in this kind of, even in the kind of hellscape that we're living in 2021. So, you know, we don't have much time left, but I want to ask kind of a closing question before we get to the Q&A, is to kind of just ask you what you think is next for the field. You know, Dr. Edwards, you were talking about kind of really, it's kind of the starting point, right, of looking at Blackness in Argentina, but also critical whiteness itself. So I want to know what you think to be the future, you know, of studies of whiteness or blanquitudes or whitenesses, you know, in relation to kind of the already prolific existent work in some places on Blackness in Latin America and the Caribbean.
Well, in Argentina, what's great and what's happening is a lot of scholars are really working with the activists. And I find that they are listening, especially to the Afro-descended Africanists, as well as Africanists that are, you know, are able to put forth, especially because of social media, what's going on. And so there has been a lot of work, at least in terms of having that dialogue, which is necessary to move forward. I mean, in the end, it culminated with the Day of Afro-Argentines, right, which is celebrated on November 8th to mark, you know, the contributions of Black people to Argentina. So I think that is what's going to need to continue to happen, is to have both scholars as well as activists come together and continue that conversation. I do want to acknowledge the gender group of the 8th of November, which is ultimately the Black feminists that have really put forth a lot of great work and are moving forward to make sure that, you know, people acknowledge what is happening, especially as a Black woman in Argentina. Critical whiteness, I also think in many ways, and I do have to give credit to a lot of the Argentine scholars that have been doing a lot of great work these last couple of years. So, and especially after the crisis of 2001, that is really where, as I mentioned, that the cracks of this melting pot of European immigration now is really exposing that it never really was there. So that's also where this, if I think about just the scholarship of whiteness is headed, that's where it is. So how will it continue to maintain and manifest in many ways? I think that's another way in which the scholarship is also looking at what's happening on the ground.
I can go next. As far as the way whiteness is being examined in Brazil, I mean, I'm not there, right? And with the pandemic, I haven't been able to go in almost 2 years now, unfortunately. But from my conversations with colleagues there and students there, what I think is happening is whiteness has become ever more part of the curriculum in universities, for instance. So yes, there's this whole popularization of the terms, right, through social media, but also it is finally becoming a serious topic of study, right, in a more formal sense. And that's very much needed. And I think it is going to become increasingly so through an intersectional lens, no doubt. So again, back to the Black feminist approach. One example of that is, and I think, John, your own work points to that, right? So thinking of whiteness through intersectional, through sexuality, gender, etc. So I think that is becoming much more the case increasingly. I also think that because, again, of still the lingering effects of the myth of racial democracy, it's really important to pay attention to how whiteness operates through these registers that are not explicitly racial, which I alluded to in the beginning of my presentation, mm-hmm. which brings me to the point of the importance of studying the ordinariness of whiteness. Right. And that is one of the major kind of guiding threads of this special issue that I'm co-editing with Anaira Musayas and Ugo Saron Anaya. And we saw that in most of the submissions that we've received. When we put out the call, you know, this is about whiteness in Latin America, most of the papers we received and the ones that will be ultimately in the issue focus on the ordinariness of whiteness. So that's one point. And then just to conclude, other elements that are very present in these papers that I also heard here from my colleagues today is still the importance of racial terms and racial categories, racial colors, right? So Erika's point about morocho, cabecita negra, etc. Puerto Rico is, you know, there's such a wealth of terms there, right? Such as the same happens in Brazil too. The racialization of class, again, a major point to be examined. Erika brought that up, is that also, and that's also in the papers that we've received. And then I would also point to the importance of studying whiteness through the production of otherness. So, which is a major way in which whiteness remains powerful because it finds a way to remain neutral, universal, the standard, the default, etc.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So I don't know. I think those are interesting directions, and what I could see is work. What I'm finding is most interesting is work that is trying to take whiteness out of the normative space, right? And try to locate it, and especially looking at, you know, how it operates through spheres of power that are beyond Puerto Rico. So look at Latino white elites, you know, and what are their roles and collaboration and complicitness with, you know, the whiteness of the metropolis of the US in this case, you know. So colonial whiteness, how does it operate even in Puerto Rico? And if we can start talking about who are, you know, the ones who are implementing colonial whiteness in Puerto Rico, then we can take it out of the normative, you know, space and point to it. And so I think that, you know, concepts like blanquito in Puerto Rico, which also is a, you know, racialized class, you know, and point to the fact that, you know, to upper class is also racialized as white, you know. And so to look at those instances, and this is a popular thing, you know, like blanquito is a derogatory term used towards a person who is conceived as, you know, arrogant and elitist. So to use that kind of a popular knowledge to take white out of the normative and specify it as a category that is also constructing, you know, colonial power, mm-hmm. and neoliberalism, austerity, and etc. So yes, that's what I see could be these interesting directions.
Excellent. So I think we might only have
time. Patricia wants to say something.
Oh, you want to say something?
I can actually make a request.
Sure.
I know we are getting near the end of the event. And I know I've seen kind of quickly really amazing questions, which
me too.
Time to address. So I just wanted the three of us, right, to have access to those questions later. Mm-hmm. So that, because I'm sure they're gonna be inspiring for our work. So, and I apologize in advance to all of the people who have raised great questions, and we won't have the chance to respond to.
Yeah, I'll put those in a document and then I'll send them to you all. There's, you know, I see a lot of running themes together through many of the questions, especially about kind of the waves of, you know, kind of the rise of the right in Brazil, you know, in the mid with the coup of 1964, but also in recent times, as well as kind of the universalism of the left in Brazil too, that kind of also buys into some regard of racial democracy, even to this day at some points, but kind of more broadly. So I'm pulling this question, especially from Steph Rice's question here about, you know, first, Professor Pinho, could you, you know, speak to the relationship between whiteness and corruption or anti-corruption, and kind of how that also comes into line with, you know, the neo-fascist rise in Brazil, with kind of the crumbling, you know, or the attempt to crumble, you know, the Workers' Party, et cetera. But then how this also speaks to Dr. Edwards and Dr. Gaudreau, your own kind of mentions and also comments about, you know, the debt crisis of 2001 in Argentina, the mismanagement, you know, with Hurricane Maria for the Puerto Rican government, you know, how a lot of this kind of seems to mask whiteness within Latin America by kind of attributing it to the degeneracy, right, of race mixing. So,
yeah, I glimpse at that question about corruption, and I think it's such an important one. And it was so easy to create to do a character assassination, let's say, of Lula, right, mm-hmm. and to say Lula is the bandido marginal, etc. Because even though Lula is not what we can call in Brazil a black man, he is definitely, he comes from poverty. He is nordestino, right? The way he speaks Portuguese, even to this day, he himself makes fun of his own kind of grammatical mistakes, et cetera, right? So, which again is about the performance of race, right? Mm-hmm. So I think that the fact that he is, even though not black, but explicitly a non-white person, with all of these performances of poverty and non-whiteness that are a part of his persona, that made the job of demonizing Lula easy. So, and that was also used to kind of expand on the issue of corruption. And the issue of corruption is very much, of course, about race, and it is about the antithesis of whiteness in this imaginary, right? And when we think of the Jornadas de Junho, the public protests that occurred, especially beginning in 2013, very much directed at the Workers' Party, it was about LGBTQ folks as corruption, because they are corrupting the traditional family ideal. It was about, you know, these black people who don't know their place anymore and want to be in college with my children. So it was about blackness, corruption, the lingering space of whiteness. So corruption has taken many shapes and many forms, and it has and I think a lot of work still needs to be done on the meaning of corruption to do the job of whiteness.
Final comments from Dr. Gaudreau, Dr. Edwards?
Well, I mean, the issue of colonial mixing is always also tied to colonial rule, right? So corrupt, the fact that we are corrupt and we don't know how to handle the federal funds from Maria, which is, you know, what the narrative that out of the Trump administration was, you know, is just in line with, you know, the colonial narrative that we cannot govern ourselves, you know, and the reason why we cannot govern ourselves is because we're not truly white, you know, and we are not really white, and we are mixed and corrupted. So it's, you know, it's all linked up.
Mm-hmm. Right. The multivalence of corruption is not only economic, political, but seen as moral or even biological, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And justifies colonial rule.
Right, mm-hmm. Right.
And also, just to wrap up, thinking about this, that is a great question. And these neoliberalist practices that ultimately result in first the 2001 crisis, and then, you know, I would argue in many ways, Argentina still hasn't really bounce back from that. You know, we have these continued debt crisis that happen over and over again. And then this shift of blame as this, you know, person who posed this question right now, it's all those Bolivians and all those Paraguayans and all those that live in the Vishas and, you know, always constantly those darker iterations of what is negro, you know, is always a problem. And so you just constantly keep seeing this, and this is a way then to just ultimately shift the blame to those others, right, that are now corrupting this notion of what is Argentina, this imagined notion of a homogeneous white nation. But luckily we have these activists that are in both Black and Indigenous that are coming forth and trying to change, and are changing, I should stress, the narrative.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think we might be out of time, but I wanted to thank Dr. Patricia Piñon, Dr. Isar Goudreau, and Dr. Erica Edwards for their lovely contributions. I think this conversation could have gone, you know, for another hour very easily and could produce many dissertations and many books and many articles. It was a pleasure being with you all. I want to, you know, this is our last roundtable of this series. I want to thank the Center for Latin American Studies, as well as our, you know, generous sponsors to make this series happen. And thank you all for joining us today. And we hope you have a wonderful week and stay safe and healthy. Take care.
Thank you. Muchas gracias.
Obrigada.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Goodbye.